Hi, this is Dr. Omar Danoun, a neurologist. Today I will talk about the neurological complications of COVID-19. I will talk about the short-term complication and the long-term consequences. We know that COVID-19 is a multi-organ disease. That means it affects so many organs in the body. It can affect the lungs, the heart, the kidneys, liver, intestine, muscles, and even the brain and nerves. The acute neurological complications usually happens during the first few days of admission when the patient is in the hospital or at the beginning of the disease. Usually ranges from 15 to 84% and happens in the first 1 to 4 weeks. There are mild to moderate symptoms like lack of smell, anosmia, headache, confusion, disorientation, what we call encephalopathy. Sometimes can affect the muscles, what's called myopathy. Sometimes there are severe complications, which are rare, like seizures, stroke, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. It can even affect the brain and cause inflammation, or it can cause demyelinating neuropathy, which are affecting the nerves. It's important to understand, how does COVID-19 affect the brain? There are multiple theories on this. First, the entry to the brain is believed to be through the blood, the nerves, and there's an important receptor, the ACE2 receptor, which happens in many places in the body that can be the first of entry. We should always remember the cytokine storm, which is an excessive inflammation and fighting of the immune system, which can affect the body as collateral damage as well. There is always hypoxia and decrease in the oxygen, which affects the brain function. There is a concept of microthrombi, which are very small blood clots that clog the small blood vessels called capillaries, and that can affect the body and the brain as well. And there is sometimes post-infectious autoimmune disease where the immune system is still agitated and is still fighting the virus even afterwards, and it can affect the body itself. And lastly, there is a theory of a neuroinvasion, which the virus attacks the brain cells directly, which is luckily a rare thing to happen. When we do testing in the first few days, we should always do a complete history and neurological examination to see if there's anything can stand out. Also, when we test, most of the testing come back negative, so we should rationalize doing tests, and we should start or consider doing a brain MRI to see if there's anything in the brain. And we can do neurophysiological studies like doing an EEG when we're suspecting seizure, doing an EMG when we're suspecting a nerve or muscle disease. And sometimes we go to do a spinal tap in rare cases when we suspect some brain infection. The long-term complications are so many. People usually call them post-COVID syndrome or long COVID, and sometimes they're called long haulers. Usually it happens after 8 to 12 weeks of the infection. Most commonly is a brain fog when patients have memory issues, difficulty focusing or multitasking, word finding difficulty, and cognitive issues. It can have extreme fatigue, tiredness, and issues with sleep, which is completely non-refreshing. Sometimes patients will have headache that can be constant and sometimes very excruciating. In other cases, patients will have a peripheral nerve disease with numbness, tingling in their extremities, hands, and feet. Or sometimes they are affected the autonomic nerves that they control the internal organs, and patients can have problems with regulating blood pressure and heart rate and dizziness when standing. And lastly, they have muscle disease with muscle aches and pain and sometimes weakness in the muscles. It's very important to consider the psychotic manifestations that happens due to COVID or after COVID. Patients will have anxiety, depression, and PTSD. And all of those are due to patients having a life-threatening experience during the infection. Sometimes it can be new, and sometimes can be exacerbation of an existing condition or not very manifested condition. So it's very important to address and treat any psychiatric symptoms for a good recovery. When we consider testing and evaluation for long COVID-19, it's the same as acute. You should start with a complete history and physical examination, and they are also low yield and mostly negative. So we should also rationalize. We can do a brain MRI, we can do EEG, we can do EMG, or do other physiological testing and studies. When we talk about treatment of long-term COVID, it's done in a multidisciplinary fashion. It means that there is a team of doctors and medical providers that they all collaborate together with multiple specialties that they treat a patient in that environment. usually it's symptom specific, means like any symptom the patient have will focus on that. Sometimes we refer patients to physical therapy, to speech therapy, to cognitive rehabilitation for memory and language. And we always should provide a very good healing environment by optimal blood pressure control, diabetes control, cholesterol management, and any other medical conditions. Thank you so much for listening. This is Dr. Omar Danoun. And please let me know in the comments if you want me to discuss any other subjects of your interest.